Hi, Carol here. Warm welcome to my craft room. Well, I was inspired by a picture I saw on Pinterest of two birds, warblers, and I decided to paint them on this Fabriano watercolor paper, which is 50% cotton. And I like to have a lot of cotton in the watercolor if I'm going to do a ton of layering. I'm going to draw it out with my Inktense pencils. That way it's kind of like a no-line coloring, in the sense that you're going to do it with lighter colors. So I decided to start with this orange and a yellow, and then I'll darken it up for you to view. It took me, let me see, I saw the picture yesterday and I decided to sit down and draw two little birds, and I will reference that same picture on my description box there so you can see it. But one thing I like to do as I'm drawing the branch is I started out years ago with enjoying to do cartooning. I love to draw, and cards came into play much later for me, approximately 4 years ago actually. But I used to like to come home from work and then to relax I would draw. And I think other than cartooning, I really enjoy cartooning, what I like to draw are birds and flowers, like floral. So this gave me the opportunity to both draw flowers, just little watercolor flowers, nothing too crazy, and birds. Birds are beautiful to watercolor for so many reasons. One, you get to layer and layer and layer, and my goal was with these birds and to make a card, I wanted to push myself to see if I could get watermarks that would look like feathers. And in order to do that, for me, now I'm not trained in art at all. This is totally just something I like to relax and do, is draw. And two little birds, really, it's not that intense. What is trying to push it to get some realism in the watercoloring. And watercoloring, I'm not that experienced with watercoloring, until it became the craze a few years back. And I don't get enough practice in, but when I do, my goal is to draw and see how much texture. You know I'm crazy about texture. But to see how realistic in some ways. Because watercoloring is a free-form art. And you don't have to be precise when you watercolor. But there are areas, I think, especially with birds. And floral arrangements, I guess. But birds, just getting down the 3D effect so that it looks like a bird, right? Yeah. So, but what I'm trying to get at is I knew I was going to use lots of watermarks, so that I could make those watermarks look like feathers in all different colors. And instead of just putting it on and shading like I would my Copics or pencils, I decided to use the watermarking, like use that those lines that you get when you dab off in my favor, so that it would look like individual feathers eventually. It was a tad difficult in my editing to know what to keep out and what to put in, because if I slowed it down while I was doing the actual layering, it would have taken probably a couple of hours, and I knew not to have you sit through that, because I was going at a very slow pace, just experimenting with the watercolors. Here I took the Molotow, I squeezed it out, and whatever I want to whiten up, and this paper is not white, this is like a cream colored paper. So I knew I wanted the top bird underneath the breast, actually underneath the back wings. I wanted to use the Molotow and on the eyeballs. So I put that in there, you'll see it's kind of blued out right there. See the bluing? And I'm using the masking there. I'm cleaning my brush. This is just an old brush I use for just placing Molotow, any type of masking fluid on, because you'll never use it for anything else. So now what I'm going to do is lay a base. I'm going to mix my colors, and here you can see I'm trying to get, you don't want to use straight black. You don't want to use a straight color at all, actually, because if you're new to watercoloring, and I'm fairly new, if you're new to coloring, and the fun of watercolors is experimenting with your coloring. What color can you mix? Keep mixing, keep experimenting, and you will find it very relaxing to see what you come up with, you know, in different tones and colors. You know, it's amazing. So I'll explain it as best I can here. First of all, I'm setting a base on this cotton, 50% cotton paper. I know it's going to take a lot of water, and for me to see and make these water lines so that I get the feathers to look separate, like feathers with the watermarks, as best I can, that was my goal. I'm going to have to lay a base, pick it up with the paper towel, then lay another base. Here I realize, yes, I'm going to use a lot of water. So I put the medical tape down, holding it just on the edges. This is a really, Fabriano paper is a good watercolor paper. Once I get the medical tape down, I wanted to use a lot of the paper space, so I'm trying to get it right over to the edges here, and it worked very well. That's one thing. I knew I was making a card for somebody, and the one thing I wanted to, you know, if I was just practicing mixing colors and whatever, I would use my Michaels watercolor paper, something that is not as costly as, say, this is, which it's very reasonable, but I mean, it does cost more, so you have to think of that. You don't want to practice on good paper. Although I do cut some little sheets up just to see what they, you know, I cut them into eighths, a separate sheet, just to see what the colors look like on this specific style of paper before I begin. So I did take a little bit and just wanted to see how the water seeps in, you know, how much mixing I'm going to have to do, whatever. But it only took a couple of seconds. I just wanted to see the feel of the paper before I began, because I'm used to working on the Michaels watercolor paper, and it has a lot of tooth, and so you lose a lot of your water and color actually in the tooth of the paper, where this Fabriano cotton paper doesn't have a lot of tooth. It's beautiful to work on, so that's another difference, you know, you have to consider when you're doing any type of technique like I'm trying to do here, and that is working the feathering, working the layering, so that I can get kind of a look of feathers at the back and the wings. So now I'm trying to consider what the color is going to look like. So I dry it quite a bit. I want to see how much it's going to lighten up and how much I'm going to have to lay back down. I know it looks rather funny that I put the color down and then I grab paper towel and I pick it back up, but really it does absorb into the paper. And right there, as I did that, and I would just layer upon layer. And I think it was nice practice, you know, I wanted to take my time and just see how I could mix colors. It was really a practice sheet, as well as with mixing colors, and as well as trying to do this kind of a technique I had in my head, because I knew watercolor moves around, and if you can manipulate the movement, I think you can do a lot of different techniques with watercolor. So I'm going to look forward to doing that. And I thought, okay, what cuter birds to do than these two little birds? I thought I would just explain when I speed up the work, once I went in on the edit, I didn't know I was this far up when I was doing, even though I could see in the viewfinder of the camcorder, but I really wanted to get the watercolors and the picture in when I probably should have came down onto the bird a little bit more, but I will do another one if you do like it. Here, while the color is dry, I decided to take the Molotow off so I could work on that. I wanted to, I wanted the watercolor to move on that spot there, even though it's going to be lighter. So as I'm speeding it up, I'll kind of explain my motives here. I wanted where the Molotow was placed, I wanted to keep that quite light because I was working in different yellow, orange, red hues. And in the feathers, I was working with quite a bit of red, navy, like a burgundy, to make this raven type color of the wings. Experiment with different deep tone colors when you're doing wanting to represent the color black. And I like to see a lot of burgundy in my blacks and red. And then I do put some yellow and orange mixed in there. You'll see me do that more so, I think, on the bottom bird than I do here on the top. But I am experimenting with all kinds of colors because these birds, if you look them up, the warblers, they come in beautiful colors, just gorgeous. The same thing when I'm going in with the leaves and the flowers and the branch. I'll start out lighter and I'll work my way to a darker tone of color. And I wanted, at the end is when I will put in all the shadows and, you know, working with the light source and such. So right now I just want to see what kind of green colors I can get by mixing up the paints. And so I'm working, actually you can't see the top colors there. I actually use quite a bit up there later on, I think with the second bird. And like with my, this is the thing I wanted to explain. You know, different people have different ways of coloring, of course. And my thing is undertone colors. For some reason, I like to lay that down first. So I'm going to speed up the coloring process so it doesn't take all day. I just wanted to share how I wanted this to look when I was finished. I wanted the flowers to be more watercolor looking, more free form, not worried about having them look realistic as I am with the birds. My total thing was trying to lay enough water and then pat it off so that I would get that bleed mark, and then come in and put color. That's what I'm doing with the larger brush with the water. Then add some color and dab it off so I could get another watermark close to the other one, so it would look like feathers. And that was my goal with the birds. And then with the flowers, I was experimenting to make them look more like a background, almost like a background shadowy bokeh kind of thing. You know, they're there, but the birds take the birds stand out, let me say that, more so than do the flowers. And then I'm going to put a nice soft sky in the background so that it's not, I don't want it to be overpowering, but I do want to have some blue in there. So when I hit the big brush in there and I add some water and then I put the dark color in, I'm wanting it to bleed out. And then I can just add some more. See that right here in this flower that I'm doing at the bottom, you can see those watermarks as I pat them out. So I'll put it in, I'll put some water in there, and then I'll go back. And as things are drying and I'm looking at it, this is when I'll go in with a darker color. And I had to change my water there. It's important, I think, when you're doing watercolors, you change your water often. I like my water to be clean when I'm doing it. So if you see me just reaching, it's because I'm changing the water. So I'm going to be speeding this up even more so that it doesn't take all day, because I think I've explained what my goal was, and that is to get a lot of watermarks in the birds to look like separate feathers, to get a lot of depth in the color of the birds. And I hope you really like it. So I'm going to move on, and we're just going to speed it up. And I will talk through it, but it is going to go at a faster pace so that you're not, bored watching it, because it is, I am doing two birds, and I just took you through that one. And here, before I do speed it up, I just wanted to tell you how I like to put down quite a bit of water at first and then try the color out. And then I pat it out. That way I can see what hues I want to get in there, like especially with the blacks here with the wings. My goal is to have that kind of raven black look. So I had to use quite a bit of color, like quite a bit of different colors. So to achieve that, I did have to pat it out quite a bit. And to get the delicate lines, I had to dry it first and then use my number 6 brush and lift it up and then make the delicate lines that go in there alongside the watermarks. So I'll just speed this up and we will continue to finish off these two birds. So here I am just laying all the different feathers, and then I will start to get more detailed in the colors that I want. I want to use a lot of this tangerine underneath the top of the feathers there, kind of like on the neck, just below. And not so much a red, but more of this tangerine look. I wanted to make sure that the beaks were nice and pointy, and so that's what I was going for towards the end of coloring, was getting it to look a little bit realistic if I could. And then right at the end, see how I'm putting more yellow in the feathers? I'm going to try to separate them here. If you add a lighter color, instead of trying to take away the color you have, add a lighter color in there and then pat it down, and then you can go in to do detailed work. And that's just from experimenting that I tell you that. And that's where the practice comes in, I think. You know, I need more of it. We all do with everything, right? Especially if we like to do different things. You know, it seems like we can't seem to be proficient. Well, I'm speaking for myself in one area because I like to do so much. And it's just like, I should be practicing this, or I should be doing more practice with brush lettering. I should be more practice with Copics, and you can't really do it all, but I guess you just have to have fun with it all, because I do enjoy dabbling in little bits and seeing what I can accomplish, I guess. And I really love to watch people watercolor. So anyway, we're just coming down to I think I'm pretty well done with the coloring. I'm just going to go in now and I'm going to do the shading. That's what I'm wanting to do here. You can see I'm laying quite a bit of the red, orange, yellows underneath the head. And then I'll dry it just to see what the outcome is. I'm going to go in with my Inktense pencil on the edge. I didn't want to have watermarks on the edge of the bird. I wanted them in the wings, but not on the edges. I just took out the molotov from this eye. Then I come in, actually, I white out the eye, put the black rim around the eyes, and then I come in with my Copic white liquid for the eyeballs, because it made it really white and it looked really nice out, standing with this kind of cream watercolor paper. I really like the look of it. Now, I dab quite a bit on and off, because I don't want the blue background, the sky. I don't want it to take over from my birds. I really liked the image of the birds, so I didn't want the sky to be darker, if you know what I mean. I wanted it to be light, so I'm dabbing off and putting on, and that's the beauty of this gorgeous watercolor paper. Here I'm taking it off, and I'm going to go back and put some shading in just at the last minute, and if this is the way I like it, I will stop. And now I'm putting away my paints, and we're going to get into making the card. Now I'm going to set it with the card base. I need to cut it down and pick the colors that I want in the card that I colored here as my backdrop and for making the card. And I was really pleased with this little painting. It was fun to do and it gave me some practice, which was nice. And I found I had this tangerine colored paper. I'm not sure what paper line this is, but it's a beautiful tangerine color, isn't it? In my stash. And so I made that for the back because it matched the flowers so nicely. And then I'm going to take this, it's not even red, it's kind of a poppy red that matched the flowers as well. I put that behind it and I'm just making sure it's even. And then I'm going to take this mustard yellow and I'm going to use my Martha Stewart punch so that I can have these kind of water look. They look like watercolor flowers, don't they? They kind of matched there with the ones that I drew. So I thought I would incorporate this into the card. And I'm going to need two sections of it. And that's why I like my punches, you know. Sometimes you just... You have them there, you wonder whether you're going to use them. Here's that color. Isn't that pretty? I don't know. It's like a Kool-Aid color. I don't drink Kool-Aid, but that's what it reminds me of. It's such a nice tomato. That's what it is. It's kind of like a tomato red. And I'm going to put that so that I can tone down that tangerine in the background. And then I'm going to make my own card base because I think it was... six by 7.5 inches, the card. And so I'm going to make an envelope to match. And then, so now we need the black. Now, doesn't that just pop right off there? And how I measure, I just put little tick marks where I think it's going to, you know, need to be cut. And then I cut it. And generally, it's pretty good. Yes, so I need two of them, one half an inch longer so that I can score it and put double-sided tape on it to make my own card base. And this is the Michaels black cardstock I always talk about. I really like it. It's so nice and thick. So I hope, you know, you enjoyed it. I know it was fast. It wasn't a teaching tutorial at all. It was more so... I don't know, just a relaxing time for me, and I wanted to share it with you. Taking some liquid glue here and putting it down. I'm trying to use up some of my products in my stash, and I saw that, and I thought, no, instead of using my Tombow Monomalty, I'm going to use this. And now I took this Blessing and Blessed set from Honeybee. I love it. And I decided just to put a small sentiment that says, you are a blessing, down. So I thought I'd use the Fiskars stamp press because it has the lines there and I can get it pretty straight. Look at all of that powder I put on. You want to make sure you put your anti-static powder, especially if you're using a thick vellum, any vellum actually. And so then I found two different blacks I liked. One was a lighter black and one was darker. One was fine and one was extra fine. I wanted to just see which one worked well and the extra fine won out at the end. So, yeah. So it just says, you are such a blessing. And I think that's a wonderful card to send to somebody. And let's heat set it. And this is the Stampin' Up 40-pound vellum that I'm using here for the sentiment. After I heat set it, I'm going to cut it off and just do a small flag on the card. I didn't want to take away from the watercoloring. And now I'm using the Scotch double-sided tape roll so that I can lift it up. And then I'm going to run and grab my mitt there. I love this cotton glove. I don't know what I bought that I got those gloves, and they have just worked out well because it takes all that powder off the back. And now that I have it backed onto my black card base, I'm going to cut this off and make a tiny little flag at the one end and put it just over the beak of the lower little warbling. Love these little birds. If you look them up, they're so pretty. You know, they're just a beautiful little bird. Yeah, I like my blue jays and I like cardinals, but I learned about these little warblings. I didn't know that there was a warbling out there. Now I'm going to place it down with some glue dots behind the words and the letters there, and put that in place, and then we'll work on the inside and finish up the back of the card with those yellow punched out flowers that I used the Martha Stewart punch on, and we will be getting an envelope for this. So once I get this right where I want it, right like that, it didn't take away from anything, yet it added a nice sentiment to the front. So now we have to work on the inside and the back, of course, the back. So I'm going to put the yellow on the inside like I did on the actual watercolor card as the background. So I'm just measuring it, eyeballing it here actually to fit it on here. And then we're going to carry on with some, I thought I'd just paint a dog. Yeah, I just thought this was cute, seeing we did a painting today. And just to give you a little smile there. And now I'm going to take the same tomato red, and I'm going to cut that off. And this is where I am going to write the sentiment with a white gel pen. Sometimes it's fun just to do different things on the inside of the card. And you know, generally I do four sides of my cards, but I held back and really just did a little bit on the inside and a little bit on the back because I'm going to do a matching card. I used my ATG half inch glue gun, is that what it's called? The glue gun. And now I'm setting these down, but I don't want them like that. I want them on a slant. Yeah. I don't want everything to be straight. So I just put them up in the corner, kind of like they were hung there. I thought they were so cute and so watercolorish. And I'll show you what I do with it later. I had my glossy accents on hand. Oh yes, I love that nib on the top of it. It lets it out so nicely. I got that at Sharon's store in Buffalo, the lid to the glossy accents. And I do like it. It's not even clogging too much on me. I always have this clogging issue. I hung some there, remember, a little while back. And then I grabbed my little premium adhesive pearls. That's what it's called there. I got this at Sharon's store as well. They're so nice and tiny. I'm always looking for tiny pearls. And I'm putting them on the inside because these flowers punched out stars, if you can believe it, which was kind of odd to me. But I added my little pearls in there. Generally, if you punch out a flower, you get a circle in the center, but these had little stars. Isn't that cute? Just add it to the back. And then I'm going to start on the envelope. I really liked this ombre paper that I bought at Tuesday Morning last year, and as soon as I turned it over, I knew I was going to use this green. It just matched the leaves perfectly, and I love the ombre look. And I think I bought 3 or 4 packs of it because it's so nice. I love the fact that it's white on the back when you're making an envelope. So it ended up 10.5 by 10.5, scored at 4 7/8, I think. But it is cut out to 10.5 by 10.5. And so I took my Stampin' Up! Cutter, which was closest to me here. And we're going to make the envelope. And I decided to do some, I'm double checking. I always double check to see where I have to cut it. And see how I slide down the line? The line doesn't go all the way to the bottom, but you don't have to worry about it because when you fold it, you can just crease it with your bone folder and it'll be perfect. I'm taking the corners off and we're going to make ourselves a little decoupage envelope for my little birds today. So I'm taking my Teflon bone folder, making some nice creases. And you know what else I like in this paper? It has like flames, like almost like branches, like in the paper. It's not just, you know, it just doesn't come dark to light in one color. I noticed that as I was editing. I thought, wow, that's even prettier than I thought. So I put the double-sided tape, make sure it fits, which it does. And now I want to do some decoupage. So I have to get out my Mod Podge to do this. And I found these birds in a 12 by 12 pack by Tim Holtz of paper in my stash. And I wanted this one bird right there. And I certainly did not want to draw another one on the envelope. So I thought, okay, I remember this Tim Holtz pack that had the birds in it. I'm taking my black Copic and going over the edges so none of the white shows. I'm going to go and grab my gloss, glossy accents. No, sorry, my gloss Mod Podge. Yes, that's the word. And we're going to Mod Podge the outside of the bird and the back. I'm going to actually, this is just a cheap paintbrush, I'm going to do the whole envelope. And yeah, because I'm going to mail this, but you can mail, you can actually Copic over Mod Podge. And I'm going to show you that because I'm going to do a branch with some flowers with my Copics right over top, and the Copics dry beautifully. It doesn't slide that you think it would, but it does hold. You can't get it off once you Copic color over this, which was really, I couldn't believe it myself. So I'm just going to clean up here and soak my brush. And I took my heat tool to this to dry it. And then I took my Copics, and I couldn't believe that they don't smear over top of the glossy accents. It was wonderful. So I decided just to put some matching flowers on here, like in the card, and I think the bird looks really cute. I couldn't believe I remembered I had that Tim Holtz 12 by 12 paper pack. It's a really nice paper pack. I'll have to do an album with that. And then I add some pearls in here like I did the card. And there you have the envelope. And I think I'll just punch out a tag to do the address on there. I took the glossy accents because when I mail it, I want to make sure that the best I can, these pearls are going to stay on. Let's see if that happens, right? And I put one on the little eyeball, and I'm really, really happy, except for I forgot the inside flower. So I'm adding some little pearls in here. And then the extra thing I'm going to do is take my white pen, and I'm going to go over the outside of some of the flowers just to help them stand out and match the white pearls on the inside. I think I already did it on the outside. And here we go. I'm just going to do some markings around there so it doesn't look so stark. I really did enjoy practicing my watercoloring. I don't get enough of it in, and it was a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to take a technique that you've seen on Pinterest or YouTube. There's so many wonderful watercolorists out there that we can learn from and practice. And that's kind of what I did yesterday morning. I just want some relaxed time. And I thought, okay, you know, what do you want to practice? And watercoloring. And I wanted to take out my watercolors that I haven't used for a while. I'm adding some little scallops, just little wee scallops to the edge of the card. And there you have it. Thank you for joining me. It was so much fun to find some relaxing time to practice. And like anything, you know, we're not going to grow and mature in our creative endeavors unless we practice. So this was fun for me. I certainly needed it. Thank you very much for joining me. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you for your always liking my videos and giving me a thumbs up. That is so encouraging. And I hope you had a blessed Resurrection Day of our Lord Jesus Christ. I certainly did. and time with family. It was nice. And I love the fact that I serve a risen Savior. And that's wonderful. So I had a wonderful Resurrection Sunday. And I will see you on the next tutorial. Take care, everybody.